Hello, my crafty friends. We are still in the midst of moving into our new house, and so today is the perfect time to start a brand new storytime series featuring crafting and fun stories about the world of cosplay. It's wintertime here, and this fireplace is my new favorite thing, so we're gonna cozy up to the fire and talk about something I think a lot of you might find interesting, the history of cosplay wigs. While we chat, I'm also going to show you how to detangle a wig using combs and an oil spray. This is my favorite lace front, but it's gotten pretty tangled in the back from all of the wear, so we're gonna work at it a bit. Before we get started though, please be sure to hit the notification bell, watch to the end of this video, and share with your friends if you like this new series. We're still a really new channel, so every sub really does help us out a lot. Now, let's get to work and start chatting! So you guys may not realize this, but I've been cosplaying for 20 years now. So I still remember what it was like to buy a cosplay wig in the old and dark ages around the early 2000s. Cosplay as a hobby was very, very niche back then. Most people hadn't heard of it, there were very few conventions outside of major cities, and even just being a fan of anime at school was pretty unusual. Nobody really made cosplay branded anything back then. So for wigs, cosplayers had to rely on local beauty stores, or if you were really lucky, a local costume store for wigs. I was one of the lucky ones who actually had one of these nearby, but its selection was very far and few between. They had maybe 10 wigs maximum at any given time. Shopping locally was really tough if you lived in a smaller town or if you needed a very specific style for your character. Very few people back then were comfortable styling wigs outside of a basic trim, and also you had to be really gentle with your wig as well. Most wigs at this time were really different from what you'd be used to today. They were made out of fibers called kanekalon or tokulon. These came in very realistic colors, and they had a very plasticky sheen to them, and they were absolutely not heat resistant like modern cosplay wigs. Flat irons would instantly melt the fibers. Every single person in the cosplay community knew that flat ironing or curling your wig was an absolute no-no. Don't even keep it in the same room. Even holding a blow dryer too close could potentially slag it. So without heat, how do you style your wig? You really don't. Something as simple as curling was an enormous feat, with very few tutorials out there. And so most of the cosplay world just chose not to heavily style their wigs. It wasn't really an option. What you bought was more or less what you were stuck with. So you needed to buy as close to the right color and style as possible. But obviously, these beauty shops primarily carried natural colors, instead of the anime blues and silvers that we all needed. Now, Party City did have those funky styles though, except then a lot of us ended up wearing tinsel on our heads or these horrifically shiny, horrible quality things. I remember these were called bag wigs because Halloween stores would sell them in a clear bag with a cheesy looking actor on the front. They were very, very bad and very much a last resort. So, wigs were hard to get. Wigs were hard to style, and a lot of people said, you know, I don't need a wig. I don't care if I've got blonde hair and my character has black hair, it's fine. And you know what? Nobody batted an eye back then. All of us were just cobbling together our cosplays as best we could, scouring through hardware stores and guessing out what might work so that we could just dress up as our favorite character for the day. Very few people were taking photoshoot quality pictures, and even fewer of us knew what the heck we were doing. No wig, weird wig, horrible wig, whatever, that was totally fine. Nobody had high standards, and nobody was really judging what anyone else was wearing at the con, especially our wigs, since it was so hard to find good ones anyway. So if some of you are wondering why we didn't just shop online, actually a bunch of us did. And there was one site that really circulated throughout the cosplay community, amphigory.com. Amphigory is a beauty supplier who happened to have an online storefront back then. They carried a variety of natural wigs in all kinds of styles, so no more rolling the dice and praying that your local store had exactly what you needed. And what was even better, they carried wigs in fun colors too. You could get red, you could get purple, you could get blue. Granted, there was only one single tone of blue, but you know, just imagine, a blue wig in the right-ish cut? Unheard of! Give me that blue page boy, please! Everyone ordered from Amphigory, but there was a catch. You had to order a minimum of 30 days ahead of time. That was their lead time, and if your con was less than a month away, you were not getting a wig. One reason we all flocked to Amphigory was because it was the favorite website of one of the top tier makers in the early 2000s. Her name was Katie Bair, and she was one of the only cosplay wig makers who existed back then. She was revolutionary and was doing things like straightening wigs, teaching us how to cut correctly with scissors, oh my god. Katie Bair was the one who showed us that wigs were plastic, and because of this, you could tint them with things that were meant to color plastics, like Sharpies. This is still a really common technique that cosplayers use today. Creating a Sharpie spray by dumping a bunch of Sharpies into alcohol was something that she popularized, and she even sold custom color Sharpie baths on her website. Newbie Me was so inspired by Katie Bair's wigs. I was on her site multiple times a week just looking at the masterpieces that she would come out with, and it was really inspiring me to become a better wig maker back then. In a world where most of us couldn't curl properly, she was showing us how to create ponytails and create wefts. Now, granted, those methods would look really weird to modern cosplayers. Her tutorials actually used a clear bathroom silicone caulk as glue instead of something like tacky glue or Patex. Remember, the Home Depot was the cosplayer's bestest friend back in the early 2000s. Very weird, but hey, you know, this was the Wild Wild West, and it worked. People were starting to get more and more ambitious, and they were demanding better looking wigs for their cosplays. In 2006, the first cosplay-specific wig seller hit the streets, Cosworx, which was the shop arm of the old cosplay.com forums. Cosworx sold exclusively cosplay-friendly wig colors, and most notably, two styles that everybody wanted. The Punky XL, which looked like a weird spiky mullet, and the Scruffy, which was a layered, short style perfect for all kinds of characters. The Punky XL was about as close as people could get to a spiked wig at this point before anyone knew how to properly spike, so it was really popular and almost never in stock in the high demand colors. Cosworx also consistently had its own problems and was unable to keep up with the demand either through lack of stock or poor customer service, and eventually people turned and began looking for other alternatives for their wigs. However, it was clear that cosplay was growing and demand for high quality wigs was growing as well. People were experimenting more with ordering wigs from overseas and on eBay, but this was a huge gamble. There were a few reliable companies with very good products like Ghost Cos, but there was also an enormous amount of scam companies with stolen images who would then send you poor quality wigs or wigs that were too small to fit American style heads. A lot of these Asian sites did not have an English storefront, so eBay was kind of the median for us. Ordering from China was a big risk back then, but for some it was worth it when you were faced with the alternative of paying $40 or $50 for a mediocre wig, or waiting months for something to come back into stock. And then, in 2009, Arda wigs burst onto the scene and, in my opinion, changed so much about what cosplayers expect from their wigs. Unlike many websites before them, Arda wasn't a reseller. They worked with an overseas factory to create their own line of wigs, specifically with cosplayers in mind. They used heat-resistant fiber, a brand spanking new technology in 2009 that meant that you could actually flat iron and blow dry your wigs to your heart's content. This was not their invention, but I cannot express to you how big of a game changer this was to the world of wig styling. They manufactured extra large wig caps for Americans, and they also manufactured extra thick wigs that would look really ridiculous for daily wear, but it was perfect for cosplay and enormous styling. And the best part of all, these started at $30. $30! That was significantly less than what we were paying for a basic melty auburn kinecalon wig. I know that cosplayers today think that American wig companies are super expensive and not worth it, but back then, this was an absolute steal compared to what we'd been paying up until now. Arda was immediately a success for obvious reasons, and the demand was definitely there. That very same year, the Five Wits began producing similar wigs but with a twist. These were specifically manufactured to match popular characters. Gone were the days of having to style and color your own wig just to get a kind of close match. Now, you could buy hyper-specific character wigs right out of the bag. Epic Cosplay, another company you've all heard of, popped up about a year later in 2010 with a similar brand, albeit without the color blends and the matte fiber that Arda offered. And then finally around this time in the early aughts, the world of overseas cosplay changed forever. In the early 2000s, buying your cosplay from a Chinese costume shop was really rare for two reasons. Number one, they were very expensive, and number two, they were very bad quality. However, the market follows demand, and cosplayers were demanding more and cheaper cosplays and wigs. Cosplay was a real business, and Asian shops began churning out not only inexpensive costumes, but inexpensive, good quality wigs as well. Granted, ordering from random eBayers was still a gamble, but provided you could wait the long shipping times, you could easily find expensive, high-quality wigs from companies like Lucal, Wigs Fashion, and Assist Wigs. As cosplay then continued to expand, so did the demand for specific materials. Ponytail wigs, lace front wigs, two-tone wigs, these are all products that have become readily available to satisfy cosplayer demand. A huge variety of tutorials also now exist on the internet, compared with the five or so guides that a handful of cosplayers had created, which every single one of us had read. You can learn how to tease a wig from Hihi, ponytail your own wig from Kimpatsu, and straighten a wig from Kuki Koss. You can buy whole books on this stuff now, including my own. Cosplay is a true industry now, with all of its pros and cons. I am beyond happy with all of the amazing materials and opportunities that its popularity has brought us. But sometimes I do get a little nostalgic, and I think about the simpler times, back when we were dumping canned color spray on a melted beauty wig and calling it perfect. Ignorance is sometimes bliss. If any of you guys experienced the wonders of the wig dark ages, tell me down in the comments below. I really love reminiscing about this stuff, and I'd love to chat some more. Also, let me know what kind of stories you want to hear for our next crafting session. I definitely plan on making more of these, and I'll see you next time.